Hello and good morning, friends. Welcome to the CC Edited Live Lecture. Dear friends, with our ongoing series on history of English literature, so far we have conducted numerous sessions. Almost 27 lectures have been conducted, and we would like to tell you all that today also we would be taking the series forward, and under this series we would be talking on the postmodern wave. In the first session, we would be talking on the topic cheerful nihilism reigns, whereas in the second sessions we would be talking on the literature exhaustion. And for this very discussion, we have once again with us in our studios Professor Bhim Singh Dahiya. Professor Bhim Singh Dahiya is a formerly Vice Chancellor of Kurukshetra University. He has authored a book called A New History of English Literature. So dear friends, we believe that he is the most appropriate person to talk on the topic, the postmodern wave. So we would like to welcome our guest, Professor Bhim Singh Dahiya. Hello sir, welcome to the Edited Lecture.
Thank you. Well, talking of the postmodern wave, we shall have to go into the history of English literature. We have to understand where it appears, in which period of history. The very name suggests after modern, it will be postmodern. But when was modernism there in English literature? Modernism was the phenomenon of the 1920s post-war period after World War I. There came a very highbrow, high flyers, a very a bully kind of pair of poets, theorists called Ezra Pound and T.S. Eliot. Well, they became the pioneers or the custodians of modernism. They rejected wholesale the traditional poetics and poetry, especially Victorianism. They thought it was too naive, it was too simple, and it was too straight and direct. That is why Ezra Pound came out with the reverse of all that. And he said, poetry must be indirect, not direct. And poetry must be difficult, not simple. And poetry must be objective, impersonal, and not subjective and personal. So these were the three main strands of modernism, rejecting the entire tradition which had come down from 16th century, from the Renaissance to the Victorian, and they brought about radical changes in both poetry as well as criticism or theory of poetry or poetics. Now, where did it come from? This came from the continental influence, as it is called, particularly the French. As Italy was the center for European poetry and poetics right from Renaissance up to the 18th century, in the 19th it was Germany which gave the lead, a romantic tradition. Then later, in the early 20th, when modernism came on the scene, it were the French who provided leadership to the European world of literature and literary criticism. Now, who were these French writers? It were three or four leading theorists who gave a theory of new kind called modernism. Among these, first was John Barth. John Barth wrote a very radical essay called Death of the Author. Death of the Author. Because before that, talking of literature without the author could not be imagined. After all, what are you talking about? You are talking about somebody's writings. And that somebody, you say, does not exist. Death of the author. The original idea of the death came actually from Nietzsche. Nietzsche was a German philosopher of later 19th century and early 20th, you can say. He came out with the idea of death of God theory. The idea is that in the modern times, it is a godless world. Until the end of the 19th century, until the Victorian age, and in fact before World War I, people used to believe in God. They were church going, and they would believe that all that happens in life is determined by God or gods over there in heaven. We are on earth. But then Nietzsche came and said, we are in a different world now. There are no gods. So death of God, that is how he explained. He had a point. Because after World War I, which ended in 1918, there was a total disillusionment, total darkness. People didn't know where to go because they had seen such a holocaust, millions of people blown up like pieces of paper, killed uncountable people. So obviously, those who had seen all that, how could they believe in God or gods? If they were gods, what were they doing when all this happened? If they cannot prevent this, then why the hell should we believe in them? Which means man is his own master and can create heaven as well as hell both. And they did. World War I was no less than a hell, where millions of people were killed and double the number disabled, rendered useless for life. So obviously in such a world, disillusionment was bound to take place. And that's why Nietzschean philosophy of death of God became very catchy. People got attracted to the idea. But they saw before them millions of people butchered. What was God doing? Was he on a holiday or what? So these were the questions raised. And on the same pattern of death of God came death of the author. This article written in 1968, death of the author, it had a great impact. The point he was trying to make is that art should not be personal. No doubt it is written by someone. Someone writes a poem or a novel or a short story or a play. But then it is not autobiographical in the first place. Secondly, it is wrong to trace his personal traits in his writings. Well, sometimes you are just wanting to narrate an interesting story, an interesting tale. At times, you feel strongly about something, good or bad, and you come out with a happy or a sorrowful poem. Now, it has nothing personal about it. So, literature, they said, is all about life and not about persons and personalities. Hence, they declared the death of the author. And there started this wave of postmodernism. Because the modernists, Pound and Eliot, they had not declared the death of the author. For them, author was very important, was a link in the chain of tradition coming down right from the beginning to the present. And great writers were great landmarks in building up and in continuing and in strengthening, in enriching the tradition. But these postmodernists decried all that. They discarded, rejected, and said, let us declare the death of the author. What is there on the page is a texture of words, is an arrangement of words, and therefore it has to be understood and interpreted and analyzed in terms of linguistic nuances. And your linguistic skill will be on test. How much really do you know the language? So both your efficiency in the language as well as your limitations, both will come forth and will be tested. So this is what the postmodernists did. After death of the author came several other essays as well, because there were other writers like Foucault and Derrida, Lacan, so on and so forth. So all these writers came to be called postmodernists. Now Derrida came out with something even more radical. He came out with the theory of deconstruction. He emphasized that the task of literary criticism is not to construct or reconstruct an already given piece of writing in poetry or prose. The job of a critic, the function of criticism, is to deconstruct the constructed literary piece. How was the whole thing created? What went into the making of the text? So the focus shifted completely from the maker, the creator, the author, so to say, to what is created, what is produced, what is constructed in words. And therefore, death of the author. Author was made irrelevant. It is textual, it is linguistic study, and it has to be analyzed in terms of language only, not in terms of the author, nor in terms of his times, because earlier you remember there used to be historical criticism. Every piece of writing in literature had to be related to its times. And you had to understand the history of those times. History not political, socio-cultural history. What kind of life people lived at that time? And why only this and this kind of literature was written and no other? Because after all, it were these very conditions of life which determined the kind of literature that came out. So, it had to be related to the history, to the milieu, to the environment, to the society, to the people, their way of life. Which means it was not independent of all this. But these postmodernists insisted that it was independent of all this. And the only relevant thing for its study is language. The knowledge of language, the knowledge of linguistics. So, the whole business of literary criticism got deflected, diverted, and was shifted to another plane altogether, altogether new. So here one had to study the language, its nuances, its linguistics, its stylistics, all these. Nothing about the author, nothing about his nationality or country or people, nothing about the age in which he wrote, only about the language in which he wrote. And that's why the more important writer during this period, postmodern, became Ferdinand de Saussure. He can be called the father of the modern linguistics. He wrote a book called A General Introduction to Linguistics. And that changed the whole ground for literary study. There came a complete break between the tradition that had been right from the time of Aristotle to the beginning of the 20th century and what followed in the so-called postmodern, means after the war, post-war period. So your history goes, your author goes, your tradition goes, your forms and structures go. Only thing relevant remains is language and linguistics. Now Saussure gave a new kind of approach to language. That new kind was that you cannot define things individually, absolutely, and for all times. Because nothing exists in isolation. Everything is related to everything else. And therefore, it is these relational links which one must know before you can feel authoritative about analyzing or interpreting a literary piece. Hence, Saussure became important, Ferdinand de Saussure. And one of the fundamental radical things that Saussure said was that in language, words, terms, terminology, all has to be defined in terms of what it is not. A very strange way of doing it. For example, if you want to talk about the fan, you say it is not a table, it is not a chair, it is not a wall, it is not this or that, well, it is not 1001 things anyway, but that is how things went. We'll take it up later after the break. Thank you. Thank you. Well, to resume the story of postmodern wave in Europe and in particular in England, because we are more concerned with the history of English literature. But then, by the time we reach the 20th century, this history does not remain in isolation. It gets linked up with European history. And in fact, now the sources of its governance, so to say, are outside. It is the writers in France, mostly French, who are calling the shots during the postmodern period. I mentioned one, John Barth, who wrote the famous essay 1968, Death of the Author. And I explained the implications of this declaration and how our attitude, our interpretation of literature changed thereafter. Another name that we must know after John Barth is Michel Foucault. Michel Foucault, again French, he also wrote a few radical things. One of which was Archaeology of Knowledge, unheard of before Foucault. Archaeology was related to digging of earth, older civilizations, so on and so forth. It was never used in the context of knowledge. So for the first time, he spoke of the archaeology of knowledge. In other words, that knowledge also is not unrelated. And it's not out of nothing. And it's not just an individual opinion. After all, where does your knowledge come from? Where do your ideas emanate from? There has to be a background to all that. There has to be a tradition. And hence, archaeology becomes relevant, important. So this idea came for the first time from Michel Foucault, who wrote that famous essay and book, in fact, Archaeology of Knowledge. He also wrote another important piece, History of Sexuality. And it was not a traditional kind of history. Foucault came out with radical ideas about gender and sex. He said, what we understand by man and woman, they are not God-given. And then not been the same all through the history of mankind. He says what we in the 20th century understand by what is man and what is woman, this was formed in the 19th century, particularly the Victorian age. And the dominant forces, say Christianity in the European countries, religion, so to say, and power, politics, they determine even about gods, even about our so-called religious life. So it is imposed from there. So these ideas came from Foucault, archaeology of knowledge, history of sexuality. So sexuality, he says, is not sanctioned by God. It is man-made. And it is man-made because man has been dominating. He has been the master of societies. So male dominance has done injustice to the other sex. And from his own viewpoint, for his own convenience, and for his own comfort, he has defined what a woman is and what are the natural performances or duties of a woman, so on and so forth. So very radical ideas Foucault came out with in History of Sexuality. And it showed how it's not very old, what we believe today. It's just 200 years old. And it keeps changing. So very enlightening ideas came up during this phase of what we call postmodernism. Because modernism was essentially traditional. The leaders of that movement, Ezra Pound and T.S. Eliot, were actually medievalists. They were conservative Christians. And they wanted people to continue with that culture of church going. Very rabid kind of conservatives. And very cleverly, they sold medievalism in the name of modernism. It was anything but modern. It was rabidly medievalist, not modern. But they were able to sell it. Not only sell it, they were able to bully the whole world, making them accept their dictation. So they became great dictators in literature studies all over Europe, for a time, of course. Because when we come to the postmodern phase, they are questioned, they are challenged, and finally they are discarded. But then for a time, 20, 30 years, they had their great dominance. In fact, even more. Because Death of the Author essay came out in 1968, whereas Pound and Eliot came up to dominate during the 20s itself. So well over 40 years, they had their sway in literary studies. And they became demigods, not to be challenged, only to be obeyed, only to be worshipped. That kind of status they enjoyed. But thanks to these postmodernists, beginning with death of the author, John Barth, and then Michel Foucault, Archaeology of Knowledge and History of Sexuality. And then next, Jacques Derrida, again a French. And Derrida came out with his new instrument of literary criticism, deconstruction. And it became a whole school of literary theory and criticism, deconstruction. Because he insisted that we needn't take any piece of writing on its face value. We must try to learn how the whole thing came about, how the whole thing was constructed. So deconstruction means to understand the process of construction which has gone into the making of a poem or a play or a novel. Only then you will understand what the whole thing is about. Otherwise, if you just take it on its face value and don't apply your mind, don't analyze it, don't scrutinize it, don't interpret it, then obviously you are not doing the job of actual rigorous literary criticism. So that's where Michel Foucault and then Derrida, Jacques Derrida, they became relevant. And it is they who are still dominating in this phase, which is continuing, postmodern. We are still continuing in the postmodern phase, although there have been stray voices of dissent, voices challenging these authorities. But they are yet to be dislodged, yet to be set aside, yet to be replaced by some new literary theory, some new ideology to approach literature. Of course, simultaneously, parallel to it all, right from the days of modernism, there has been a parallel movement in the Eastern Europe, because after the influence of Marx, Europe got divided into two. The Russian bloc means Eastern Europe, and the American or Western bloc, where Anglo-American influence prevailed. Or in other words, capitalism and proletarianism, Marxism, two opposites. And these very ideologies were practiced not only in politics or in social life, but also in literary criticism, in how to respond to literature, how to go about in education. So all aspects of our life got divided sharply into two worlds, the East and the West, the Marxist and the capitalist, or the socialist and the capitalist, which is still continuing, of course, not so sharply, because the socialist bloc could not sustain itself for long. The power of money on the other side, the Western side, the Anglo-American, they wrecked international business, politics. So they destroyed the system in the East, and ultimately the East had to fall in line with the West. So today, even in Russia, or why Russia, even China, you can see the same fundamental principles of capitalism ruling the markets, ruling the countries. So, literature and literature studies, literary theory and literary criticism cannot and has never been a study in isolation. After all, it is one of the activities of a people. Education as a whole also is a social institution, and therefore it grows out of the kind of life the people have, because it is that life which is going to shape your social institutions also. It may be education, it may be marriage, it may be even the political institutions, your cultural life. All these are determined by the dominant forces. So literature cannot be separated from the entire way of life people have at a given time. So in the postmodern phase, the kind of life that came about was really not compact, uniform, and unitary. There is an essay by Krishan Kumar. The name sounds very familiar, Indian, but actually he is a South African, must have gone there a few generations ago, his family. But he is nationally South American. He has a very sensible essay. I am very fond of reading it. The Postmodern Condition. There are definitions and definitions, explanations and explanations of what is postmodern, and yet none of these by itself is satisfying to us. There is always something. Is left lurking in our mind, feeling uneasy, as if part of the truth has remained lost somewhere, and therefore we look for it wherever we can find it. So Krishan Kumar has a sensible thing to say on the postmodern condition. That's the title of his essay also. He says, most theories claim that contemporary societies show a new or heightened degree of fragmentation, pluralism, and individualism. It can also be linked to the decline of the nation-state and dominant national cultures, political, economic, and cultural life is now strongly influenced by the developments at the global level. This has, as one of its effects, unexpectedly, the renewed importance of the local and a tendency to stimulate subnational and regional cultures. Very fantastic kind of thing. Imagine how contradictory life is in our time. On the one hand, we speak of pluralism, multiculturalism, globalization, international business marketing, economy, so on and so forth. And yet, there is more and more of localism, subnationalism, splitting society into the minutest possible grouping on the basis of one thing or the other. You must have seen of late the tribal assertion. They don't want to lose their identity. So these assertions of the local identities, this is working in one direction. And in the other, the forces of internationalization or globalization. And the conflict between the two creates all sorts of tensions in our life. And to be able to reconcile them, there lies the success. Those who are not able to do that, they will suffer the tension and they will suffer the torture. So it may be literature or literary criticism, or it may be life in general. The issues that you confront are not dissimilar. They are just about the same. And you have to learn to understand them. and to reconcile them. It's only then that a smooth sailing can be possible. Otherwise, you will remain lost, confused, as people were after World War I and then after World War II. They took quite some time to come back on their feet, to come back to their moorings, to come back to their senses, so to say. So that is what happens. Thank you for the day.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so very much for giving us a very, very productive session once again. And dear friends, we would like to tell you all that if you have any queries, then you can mail us at info.cc@nic.in. We would be meeting again tomorrow and we would be discussing on the age of theory. So till then, take care. Goodbye. Thank you, sir. Thank you so very much.
Thank you.